Christy, and welcome to Lifesprings Online. We're so excited that you chose to worship with us today. If this is your first time, please scan the QR code on the screen so that we can connect with you and give you a free gift. If you want to stay up to date on all that's going on at Lifesprings Church, text 411 to the number on the screen, and you'll see everything going on. If you would, take a moment and share this broadcast, and don't forget to like and subscribe on all of our social media platforms, including Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. The more you do, the further the gospel spreads on social media. We've got a great service in store for you today, and we want you to get ready to worship God. So, for those of you with kids, go ahead and get them ready for their own service by heading over to lifesprings.online/kids for a virtual kids service. All right, it's time to worship. Go ahead, get yourself pumped, and if you're physically able, please feel free to stand. Let's make wherever you are a place of worship so that you can lean into the presence of God.
Thank you. changes what? Jesus changes everything. Raise your hand if you've been changed by Jesus Christ. And if you can't raise your hand, I want you to know you're in the right place. Chains can fall. Fear can bow. Anxiety can be told to leave. Demons have to flee at the name of, say his name. This is the first weekend of the month, and we've made a commitment that on the first Sunday we're going to take communion. So if you'll watch it online, maybe you want to pause this and get you some juice and crackers. It don't have to be like we have here. It can be anything. It's about symbolism. I know in the Bible it says he took the bread and the wine, and we don't do wine here for various reasons. One is because we have so many recovering alcoholics that we certainly wouldn't want to be a part of that. But you can use Coca-Cola if you want to, or water, or whatever. It's really about a heart thing. But if you're in these services or in here in the lounge in the seat back, there's a little holder. If you'll get a communion cup, don't open it yet. Let's just talk for a few minutes. This is not something for members of Lifesprings Church. This is for something for members of the kingdom of God. This is for Christians. And so if you're in this place today and you're not a Christian, today, I believe while we take communion, you can be accepting Christ as Lord and Savior. Would you go ahead and get your heart ready right now, though? Let's get in a posture of worship. The Bible also says, even for Christians, that when we do communion, we should make sure our heart is clean, and we should make sure that we have asked God to forgive us of our sins, because if we do it unjustly, we could actually be drinking judgment on ourselves. So this is not just a good little time to eat a bland piece of bread and some juice. This is a time for us to consecrate ourselves and get reverent. Would you tune out any distractions right now? And if you don't know Christ as Lord and Savior, would you say, God, I'm sorry for my sins. Today as I take communion, I'm accepting you as my Lord and Savior. I believe you died for me and rose again in 3 days. And I want to serve you to the day I die. If that's you, if you're in this place and heads bowed, eyes closed, and you say, Dale, I think I'm making a commitment right now to Christ. I've not been walking with the Lord, or I've been backslid. It's been a long time since I walked with the Lord, and today as I'm taking communion, I'm asking for Jesus to change everything in my life. Would you hold your hand up if that's you? You're kind of coming back. I just want to celebrate. I want to celebrate. I see two hands right now. Come on, I see three hands. Come on, can we celebrate that right now? Three hands, at least three hands. Come on, I think there's four hands, I think, right now. Praise you, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing in this place. For every believer in here, say, search my heart, God, if there be any sin, anything in me. And then begin to confess it right now. Say, Lord, I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. Today I take communion, and I do this in reverence and honor of you. You know, Tuesday night of this past week, I was at a meeting here at the church, and I noticed somebody had already put the communion cups out. And so I guess I need to confess this. I stole one, and I took it. I don't know why. I was standing there in a meeting, and I saw it, and I was like, I just saw it, and I felt the Holy Spirit say, you need to take one of these and do communion. And I thought, no. And then a few minutes later, that happened three times. I was in a conversation with somebody, and I just reached down and picked it up, and I said, I don't know why I'm taking this home, and I'm going to take it home. And then on Wednesday, which I didn't know was the first, I didn't even pick that up until actually earlier in this service, I was noticing that, and I just couldn't get away from it, and I did something I've never done. I'm ashamed to say I've been a Christian for 40 years, or longer than that, 42 years, and I've never done a private communion. And I just, me and God, one-on-one, I just poured it out. And I have to be honest with you, I'm probably going to steal some more communion cups. Let me just go ahead and tell you, okay? That, it did something to me. And that day I was having a lot of anxiety and a lot of stress and a lot of worry. And I just felt the Holy Spirit. It's like God knew. Did y'all know God knows? Come on, somebody say God knows right now. He knew I was going to need that day. And I just felt the Holy Spirit saying, remember why. Remember why. Remember why. Remember why you got into this to start out with. Remember why you show up anyway. Remember why we do this anyway. Remember why. Say remember why. I just felt this protection. And it took me back. I'm going to read a passage. It's not a traditional communion passage. If I can see it, I'm going to try to read it. I don't bring in glasses. But here's what it is. Revelations 12, 10 through 11. Then I heard a loud voice shouting across the heaven. It has come at last, salvation and power and the kingdom of God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters has been thrown down to earth. The one who accuses them before our God day and night. You know what he's talking about here? When Satan was cast out of heaven. He was an angel that was cast down. And he's cast down to accuse the brethren, the sisters, you, to accuse us before God and tell us we're not worthy. And the truth is we're not. To tell us we're not good enough. And the truth is we're not. To tell us that we're nothing, and the truth is we're not. But then listen to the next verse. And they have defeated him, watch this, by the blood of the Lamb and by their testimony. And they did not love their lives so much that they were afraid to die. How many of you know that everything in here right here, the blood of the Lamb and the testimony that Jesus died for me and he changes everything. There's power in the wonder-working blood of Jesus. Can I hear an amen right now? Father, thank you. Thank you for the body of Christ. Thank you for the bread. Thank you that I get to be a part of this body. And today I come back to my basics and I do this in remembrance of you. Would you take this wafer right out on top and hold it up to heaven and say, thank you, Jesus. Come on, ready? One, two, three. Come on again. Everybody, one more time. Would you take it with me? On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and broke it and said, this symbolizes my body, broken for you. And then he said, this is my blood spilled out for you. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. We overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Come on, would you peel this foil layer back with me? Let's drink it together. Come on, one more time. Just sing this to him right here, softly. Come on. We just want to worship him one more time in spirit and in truth. And I want you to sing it with a declaration that Jesus has changed me and is continuing to change me. Sing it to him. Come on, put your cup down in the seat back where you got it. Lift your hands right now. Jesus, you change everything. Lives healed. Hope is found right here. Everything in this cup. Jesus, you change everything. Come on, one more time. Come on, make it a little bigger. Fear, anxiety, bow. Come on. Come on. Don't leave here without worshiping God. Right now. Put your hands together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for being a God that changes everything. Thank you. We love you and we serve you to the day we die. Be in the remainder of the service and use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, say his name with me. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Look at the person beside of you and say, you're looking good. Look like you've lost weight since the last time I saw you. Go ahead and do that right now. Looking good. Amen. You can have a seat. We're so glad you're here. Amen. How many of you glad to be here? Hold your hand up. Good night. How many of you rather be in here than in the hospital? Hold your hand up. Good night. How many of you are glad to be here instead of jail? Hold your hand up good and high. All right, good. We're glad you're here. Amen. I'm so glad you're here. My name is Dale. I'm the lead pastor of Lifesprings Church, and it's an honor that you'd come out and worship here. And we never want to take that for granted. We thank you so much for that. And I'm excited about this message. We're in this series this week right now called Let's Go. It's going to be a longer series, about 7 weeks. We usually don't do 7 week series, but we are this time. And I've been on a preaching run there for a while. I started in the fall, and so I'm taking 2 or 3 weeks off here, and I'm letting our preaching team. And how about last week? Come on, somebody. Did Pastor Brian bring it down? Amen. Incredible. Incredible. And today we have our campus pastor at Selma. Pastor Jonathan is bringing it this week. He's a hobbling along, but he's no stranger to us. He's been here for a long time as we continue the series. Come on, put your hands together, and welcome to the stage, my friend, Pastor Jonathan Carter.
Hey, Hey, Pastor Jonathan.
Well, hey, how's it going?
Hey, I got something that I need your help with real quick.
Okay, what you got?
So you know upstairs that iPad that we use for the sermon notes?
Yeah.
Hey, I need you to go upstairs and plug that in for me, man.
Okay, wait. You want me to go upstairs and plug in an iPad?
Yeah, it's really important. We need it this week.
Okay. I don't know if you know, but like I've got this bum leg. It's going to be kind of hard for me to get up that hill, get up the stairs. Go. You sure there's nobody else that could do it?
Well, I do know Pastor Chris, but he's really busy right now, like really busy.
Dang, so much to do. There's so many of them. Woohoo! I got him. Let's go.
What about Pastor Shane?
I think he's in the new building collecting screws or something.
Screws?
He's
okay.
Like really busy, yeah.
Yeah, he's got a few loose screws.
Wow. Would you look at it?
Yeah, he is.
There's nobody else. Okay. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Oh! Man, I got a lot to do to get ready. Let's go!
Somebody say, let's go! I tell you, the struggle was real, somebody. You ever felt like the struggle's real, anyone?
Oh, man, all that was real. You wondering why I'm coming in on the cane? It was more because of that video than anything else. But anyway, I'm Jonathan. I'm the campus pastor at our Selma location, as Pastor Dale said. And I want to take a moment and welcome those in this auditorium, those in the lounge, the party room, online, Selma, Western Harnett. Can we just take a moment and thank God for our whole church family? Amen. Now, you might be wondering, what's wrong with me? Well, I got a long list. Come on, somebody. But I did injure my knee a couple weeks ago. I don't honestly know what happened. I had a little tumble. And if you know anything about turning 40, things change when you turn 40. Come on, am I right? A little stumble all of a sudden makes you think you're going to have to chop a leg off or something. One of the doctors said they were going to have to amputate from the neck down. I didn't know what they were talking about. But anyway, I'm so glad to be here. And honestly, I wasn't sure I was going to make it. For real. I didn't know if I was going to be able to make it because, I tell you, my knee was swollen like the size of a grapefruit. You ever seen one of them? It was painful. But I got to tell you, I decided to press on. I really did because I felt like God had given me a word that I needed to share. And so I'm excited to be here. Anyone here excited to hear the word of God? Yeah. Amen. Amen. So we're going to go ahead and get right in it because I got a long sermon. Go ahead and look at your neighbor and say, you're going to have to listen fast, okay? As you get into it, I want to make sure that you get these notes. And is it okay if I sit on this stool? Is that all right? Okay, every now and then I might try to get up, but I don't know. We'll just have to see what the Holy Ghost does up in here. But nevertheless, we're going to be getting into this sermon. So if you would like these notes, I want to encourage you to make sure to text the word sermon to the number on the screen. Let's go ahead and say it together. Ready? 919-586-8900. You want to make sure you do that. And also, you can text that same number and text the word prayer. Did you know that we've got a staff of pastors that are praying for you? Did you know that? Yeah. It is our honor to be able to pray for you. So I encourage you to do that. So as you're getting ready with that, I want to make sure you know about one more thing going on. Did y'all see that big building at the bottom of the hill? Yeah. That thing's looking nice, ain't it, somebody, right? Anyone excited for us to start worshiping in there? Anybody? Yeah. Amen. We're excited about that. And so this coming weekend on the 11th, I guess next weekend, on the 11th, we're going to have a work day. Anybody like to work? Only two of you. Okay, we in trouble, you know what I'm saying? We're going to do a work day, but this is a little bit different, okay, because I know some of you have a lot of skills, but some of you are like me and you can't hardly swing a hammer. But don't worry, this is not like you're trying to build the building. We're trying to get some things put together, like brackets for TVs and stuff like that. So if you would like to help us, please be sure to come next Saturday, March 11th. But we're doing something else too, something that everybody can do. We're going to have a prayer walk. Did you know that Jesus said, my house, the church, will be called a house of what?
Prayer.
And we want to make sure that we cover this thing in prayer because I believe there's going to be a lot of people who get saved in that building, baptized in that building, marriages restored in that building, children dedicated to God in the building. So we want to pray for it to make sure that God shows up and that this tool that he's given us is used for his kingdom. Amen?
Amen.
So make sure that you do that. Now, we're going to get into it. So look at your neighbor and say, it's time. It's time to get in it. So we're going to be looking today in the series that we've been in for a couple weeks called 1, 2, 3.
Let's go.
Let's go. It's time to go. It's time for us to move forward. And so we're talking today about Joshua once again. And in this particular sermon, the idea is who's with me? Who's with me? You ever heard anyone say that? Who's with me, right? Like, are you going with me? Are you ready? Whatever. So I want to talk to you about that a little bit today because, you know, the truth of the matter is if you're here today, and maybe you don't believe in Jesus Christ, you picked a perfect day to come to church because we're going to talk about how God has something special if you'll accept it. God's got something that he wants to do in you, for you, and through you. And if you do believe in God, he's got a promised land for you. And in this series, what we've been doing is we've been talking about how faith will unlock something inside of you, and that God has a great future planned for you, and he's got promises for you. All you've got to do is accept it. And so as we are about to move into this new building, I'm telling you, we as a church are on a threshold of something that God's going to do. And I believe he wants us to go. Someone say, let's go.
Let's go.
We've got to go. Now, 2 weeks ago, Pastor Dell started the series, and he spoke about Joshua and how Joshua had been given this amazing challenge as the new leader of the Israelites to go into the promised land. He was to take them across the Jordan River, and he was the new leader, and he had been given a group of people who, at one point, this huge group of Israelites had turned away from God, and a new generation was going in. Well, today, what I want to do is I want to pick up from there and talk about how when God showed up, he caused an entire generation to miss out on their promised land. An entire generation that didn't have faith. Now maybe you're here and you're like, what is faith? Well, Hebrews, book in the Bible, New Testament, second part of the Bible, chapter 11, verse 1, says that faith is the confidence in what we hope for, and it's an assurance about what we can't see. It kind of reminds me of the wind. How many ever seen the wind? Nobody, right? You can't see the wind, but you see the effects of the wind. You may not be able to see God with your physical eyes, but you can see the effects of God when he shows up. That's what faith is all about. But sometimes what people will do is they'll think faith is, I believe in it. If I just believe a little harder, kind of like the little engine that could, right? I think I can. But can I just tell you what faith really is? Faith is taking what you believe and putting it into action. Faith is saying, I know that I'm seeing something impossible, but I'm still going to trust God. Faith is saying, it seems very hard and unlikely, but I know that God is with me. You ever been there, anybody? Now, I want to tell you a quick little story. I used to be a youth pastor years ago in another church. And so one of the things that I looked forward to every year was summer camp. Anyone remember going to summer camp as a teenager? Oh, yeah, I loved summer camp. Well, this particular year, we were invited to a brand new camp I had never been to. It was called Camp Vineyard, great camp. But we didn't know what to expect. So I had myself and a couple other leaders, we were going, and we had, I think it was about 15 teens, middle school kids going for that thing. And we get out there to the Camp Vineyard. What they didn't tell me when I got there was that this camp was all about extracurricular outdoor activities. Now, I have gained a couple of pounds since my knee injury, but let me just tell you, your boy JC, he don't do a lot of extracurricular outdoor activities. So we get there, and everything's obstacle courses and races and sports and athletics. I looked at the other guy, I said, they should have called this Camp Fit. This is for people who know how to exercise. So we get there. And one of the things they wanted us to do, a team challenge activity, was to take all the students across one of these like 8-foot walls. You ever seen something like that? So I'm looking at myself, and I'm looking at this other guy. I won't say his name because he probably watches online, and he's bigger than me. And I size him up, and he sizes me up, and I said, we ain't going to make it, brother. It's not going to happen, you know? And so we're there. We're trying to figure out how are we going to do this because we had middle school kids. You ever seen a middle schooler? In sixth grade, they looked like fifth graders. They looked smaller than me, and I wasn't sure what was going to happen. But, you know, as the leader, you can't tell people sometimes how you really feel. Am I right? Sometimes you got to have a sense of confidence, even if it ain't there. And so I started talking to him. I said, guys, we can do this. This poor little kid about that tall said, I don't think so, Pastor Jonathan. I said, come on, I know we can. We can do this if God be for us. You know, trying to make it spiritual, right? Well, we got on the other side of that thing, and everybody was so excited, but they were trying to figure out what do we do about Pastor Jonathan. Do we push him up first, or everybody try to pull him up last? I decided to just walk around the wall. Come on, somebody, you know what I'm saying, right? Camp Fit. Well, let me just ask you a question. Have you ever been a place in your life where you feel like you cannot accomplish something? You ever felt like it seems too hard? That you're not sure you're going to make it? See, sometimes we don't take what it is that we know God has promised us because we have fear, or we have insecurity, or maybe we're uncertain. But sometimes it's because of the people that we're listening to who are around us. Did you know you can have the wrong people around you? Sometimes the people that are around you might actually pull you down rather than build you up. You ever notice that? And so this is your Lifesprings Church social media moment. Here's what it says. It says, don't follow the crowd because they usually get it wrong. You ever notice that? Don't follow the crowd because they usually will get it wrong. Well, in today's story, we're going to see how the crowd got it wrong again. And I want you to learn some things. So let me give you some context. Now, everybody say the name Abraham. You heard about Abraham if you heard the sermon a couple weeks ago. If you didn't, I encourage you to go to YouTube, check it out. But Abraham had been told by God that he was going to inherit this land, this special land called Canaan. And he was going to be the father of many nations. And so Abraham, he grew old and he had a son named Isaac and so forth and so on. And then the nation began to grow because they started having babies, right? And so God, at this point now, has taken the Israelites out of Egypt. This is before they get to the Jordan River. They're out of Egypt. They're wandering in the wilderness, and they're about to see the promised land for the first time. So God tells them, Moses specifically, I want you to get some spies to go check out the land I'm about to give you. I want you to see what I'm about to give you. And so Moses chooses 12 spies, one from every tribe, to go and check out this land. And one of them was Joshua. Joshua is going to be one of the 12 spies, and he's going to get it right. Now, I just want a spoiler alert. There were 12 spies. 10 of them didn't think it was possible, but 2 said yes. So today, we're going to be in the book of Numbers. Would you say Numbers?
Numbers.
We're in Numbers chapter 13, and if you're getting your Bible out, you might be like, where's that? It's the fourth book of the Bible. And in Numbers 13, as we go through this, I want to give you some keys of how you can possess your promised land. So if you're ready, say ready.
Ready.
Here's what it says in Numbers 13, verses 18 through 20. This is Moses talking. Here's what he says. He says, see what the land is like and find out whether the people living there are strong or weak, few or many. See, would you say see? See what kind of land they live in. Is it good or bad? Do their towns have walls, or are they unprotected like open camps? Is the soil fertile or what is it? Are there many trees? Do your best to bring back samples of the crops you see. All right? This is the mission. This is what Moses is telling these spies to do. So they're going to go out there and they start scouting it out. In fact, the Bible, if you read the rest of it, says that they went out for 40 days checking out this whole land. And then in verse 23, they start to tell us what they found out. Look at it. It says, when they came to the valley of Eshcol, they cut down a branch. Would you say a branch? A branch with a single cluster of grapes so large that it took how many? 2 of them to carry it on a pole between them. They also brought back samples of the pomegranates and figs. Now, I just kind of want to set the scene here because I believe that God has a promised land for every one of us. I believe God has given some promises to you, and it's time for us to receive them. And so I want to do a little bit of an example here. So I got a few illustrations. So I've got something here. Anybody know what this is?
Milk.
Milk, right? He said it was a land flowing with milk and what?
Honey.
Now, anybody like honey in here? Oh, yeah. Anybody like milk? I tell you, I thought about drinking it, but they poured it 3 hours ago. But if they didn't, and I had some Oreos, whoo, tell the Lord thank you, right? He said they had land flowing with milk and honey. Now, by the way, that's really not literal. There wasn't like rivers of milk and streams of honey, but it's this idea that there was abundance. If you got it, say got it. But then he said there were some other things like figs. I don't do figs, but your boy JC likes Fig Newtons. Come on, somebody. This ain't a cookie, it's fruit and cake. Can I get an amen? That's good right there. Woo, thank you, Jesus. Then he said he had pomegranates. Someone say pomegranate. I don't even know how to open a pomegranate or eat it. You know what I'm saying? So I got this juice stuff right here. Anyone ever had pomegranate juice? Mmm. Is it good for you? Never mind. I ain't going to drink it. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, laying fun with milk, honey, grapes. Let me just stop you for a second. How big were those grapes? They were so big it took how many people?
Two.
Let me just stop for a second in this sermon. I'm going to give you some nuggets every now and then. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Did you know that when God's given you a promise, it's something so big that you can't imagine? If you would just trust God a little bit, those grapes would be bigger than you think. See, the grapes that God has aren't some that you find at the grocery store. They're the kind that grow in a land that's promised for you. They're bigger than you can imagine. He said it's going to take two people to carry them things because God's got a promise. He's got a plan. He's got a purpose. And if you would just trust God in the promised land, He'll take care of you. And I want to show you a little bit about what some of these things are. Because did you know that the Bible has over 7,000 promises for you? There's over 7,000 promises. In other words, it's kind of like God is saying, greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. It's like He's saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It's like He's saying, no weapon formed against me will prosper. It's like He's saying, by His stripes, I've been healed. He's got promises for you. And if that ain't good enough, He says, I'm Jehovah Jireh, your provider. Jehovah Rapha, your healer. Jehovah Nissi, your banner. Jehovah Shalom, your peace. In other words, God's got a promise for you. And you might be here. Yeah, go ahead and give Him praise. You might be here today, and you're struggling. I get it. The struggle's real, right? It might be that God told you that one day your kid would be a pastor, but they've turned from God. Can I just tell you, if God gave you a promise, it's going to be fulfilled. That child will come back to church. You will see that marriage restored. Your kids will be blessed financially. Your healing is going to come because God has given you a promise. He's given you the promised land. And whatever He has promised to you, you know He can do it for you. If you got it, say got it. He's got a plan. He's got purpose for you. And there is a promised land. Now, a lot of times when we hear promised land, we think He's talking about heaven, and He is, because I can't wait to get to heaven. Anybody else? But let me just tell you something. Your promises ain't just for heaven. They're for this life, too. And you can have an abundant life and a blessed life if you would trust God. So what I want to do today is I want to show you some keys for how you can receive the promise that He's given you. You ready? Here it is. Number one, keys to receiving the promise. First, you got to stay focused on the promise. You have to stay focused on the promise. Have you ever noticed that sometimes it's hard to stay focused? Don't raise your hand, but does anyone here struggle with ADD? Some of us got AD triple HD, you know what I'm saying? I mean, it's okay, but it's hard sometimes to stay focused. It's hard especially to stay focused on the promises of God when everything around you looks like it's going, well, you know. Well, the spies, they had gone through the land. They're coming home, and they've seen all these amazing things. I want you to see it here in verse 27. It says, this was their report to Moses. They've come home. We entered the land you sent us to explore, and it is what it is. It is indeed a bountiful country, a land flowing with what? Milk and honey, just like God said it would. It's a promise from Him. But then He keeps going. Here is the kind of fruit it produces. But, would you say but? But. It's the but that's going to get you. It's the but that makes things wrong. He says, but, these are the 10 spies, the people living there are powerful, and their towns are large and fortified. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Anak. Now, these Israelites have seen the promise of God. They saw the land flow with milk and honey and grapes and figs and pomegranates. They saw that God's promises were true. They had never seen it before, and they've seen it today, and they've heard it. But they also saw something else. They were focused, but they were focused on the problem and not on the promise. They said, but. Would you say but?
But.
See, but, in some translations, it'll say nevertheless. but, or nevertheless means despite all of that. In other words, despite his promise, despite his word, despite the truth that I see, I can't do it. It's that but that'll get you every time. It's the problem that we see that keeps us focused away from the things of God. You ever notice that for your life? The problems of financial things, or the promise, or the problems of medical situations, or a relationship that looks like it's gone south. You've got to stay focused not on the problem, but stay focused on the promise. Why? Well, those spies came back reporting on the land. They were giving facts. They said, yeah, it's got milk and honey and grapes and pomegranates and figs. They also said it's got fortified cities and enemies and giants. All those things are facts. But what the spies didn't see was truth. They saw the facts that the land was indeed plentiful, but they also saw the facts that it had enemies. But the truth was, greater is he that's in them than he that's in the world. They saw the fact that the cities were fortified, but they forgot the truth that no weapon formed against them would prosper. They saw that everything looked bad, but they forgot that God is good. In other words, the facts were there, but the truth had left them. And the fact was that, yeah, you might have had cancer, but the truth is by his stripes, you've been healed. You've got to get to a place where you stop looking at the facts, because facts are based on circumstances, but truth remains no matter the circumstance. Whenever you go through a place in your life where you say, I'm going to believe in the truth will set you free. How many understand what I'm talking about? Hold your hands good and high. You got to believe the truth, because the facts will mess you up, won't they? Well, here it is. Keys to receiving the promise. Number one, stay focused on the promise. But number two, you have to stand firm. Would you say stand firm? Stand firm on the promise. Now, these group of people, these Israelites, these 10 spies, they come back, they're sharing their report about how terrible it was and how scared they were. And these Israelites, all the maybe even millions of people were hearing this thing, and they're getting scared. You know what scared is? It's not just scared, it's scared, right? Like it's seven scares. They're afraid. And so they're there, and one of the 12 spies stands up. His name was Caleb. Would you say Caleb? Caleb stands up, and he says, hold up. Wait a minute, put a little look. No, I'm just kidding. He said, hold up. Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses, and he said two words. What are those two words? One, two, three.
Let's go.
Let's go. He said, let's go at once to take the land, he said. We can what? We can certainly conquer it. See, Caleb had faith. He saw the facts, but he also saw the truth. Caleb saw the enemy, but he saw the blessings of God. If God said it's yours, he knew that God was going to give it to him. And so Caleb, in the middle of this, and Joshua's right beside him, they say, we can do this. We can take this. Caleb said, I'm going to stand. I'm going to stand against my colleagues. I'm going to stand against the enemy. I'm going to stand against the facts. I'm going to stand against the problem. And I'm going to trust God, because it doesn't matter what's going on. I'm going to stand. And as long as I do everything to stand, I'll keep standing, because I know my God will be able to supply all my needs. He said, I've got this. He knows it's going to happen. And he stands before God, and he stands before the people firmly and boldly, and says, we can take the land. We can take the land. But not everybody agreed. Verse 31, but the other men, would you say other men? The other men who had explored the land with him, they did what? They disagreed. They said, there's no way. We can't go up against them. Look, Caleb said, let's go. The other 10 said, we can't go. You see the difference? Caleb said, come on, we can take it. The other men said, there's no way. Listen, the crowd is going to get it wrong. Amen? The crowd is going to get it wrong. They said, we can't go up against them. They are stronger than we are. So they spread this bad report about the land among the Israelites. Now, I just want to stop there. Think about that for a second. God said, I'm about to give you a land flowing with milk and honey and grapes and figs and pomegranates. In other words, it's going to have everything you need. God said it is your land. Don't worry about who's in the land because it's yours. I said it's yours, so it's yours. And these 10 Israelite spies, they are sending a bad report. You know what they're doing? They're putting themselves in opposition to God himself. Let me just tell you. If you ever find yourself in a place where you're against God, you're not going to win. If you put yourself in opposition to him, you will lose every time. Then it keeps going. He said, the land we traveled through and explored will, one, two, three, devour anyone who goes to live there. All the people we saw were huge. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Anak. Next to them, we felt like grasshoppers. And that's what they thought too. Now, how many of you are short? Anybody short in the room? Do you ever feel like a grasshopper to somebody? Could you imagine standing next to like Shaquille O'Neal, somebody? Talk about feeling like a grasshopper, right? So these Israelites, they're sending this bad report. This crowd of 10 is trying to persuade the millions that the thing ain't going to work. It ain't going to happen. And let me just remind you, the crowd gets it wrong most of the time. Amen? Let me just tell you a couple times in the Bible when the crowd got it wrong. Noah was told by God to build a boat. Everyone around him said, it ain't going to rain, you crazy person. All of a sudden, when it rained so much that the whole earth was flooded, boy, who showed up, right? The crowd got it wrong. There was a time when all of a sudden a man named Job, who had been given blessing after blessing, lost everything. The crowd around him said, just curse God and die. He didn't, and he was blessed doubly. There was a time when Jesus could have been crucified or somebody else, and the crowd chose for Jesus to be crucified. I want you to understand, the crowd doesn't get it right, especially when it comes time to the things of God. And if you've got people in your life that are speaking against church, or speaking against a holy life, or speaking against waiting till you're married, or speaking against staying with your spouse and working it through, you've got a crowd that you've got to remove. You've got people in your life who are going to mess you up. The crowd gets it wrong. See, listen, if you follow the crowd, you'll get what you deserve. But if you follow God, you'll get what you don't deserve every time. Some of you, it's time to find a new crowd. It's time to find a new tribe. For some of you, it's time to get into small group if you're not already. You can get into a group that will change your life. In just a few weeks, we're going to have sign-ups. I encourage you to do that. But now remember, he said that we felt like what? Grasshoppers. He said we felt like grasshoppers. You know why some of you may not possess the promises that God has given you? For some of you, he's promised blessings. He's promised you'll start that business. He promises your marriage is going to be okay. He's promised those things, but you won't receive it because you have a grasshopper complex. You look at yourself as tiny and small without no purpose. But I want you to understand, if God has given you a pulse, he's given you a purpose. If you're alive, he's got blessings for you. He says, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. Don't look at yourself as small. You might say, I can't start that business. I can't leave that relationship. I can't overcome anxiety. But what I want you to do is hold your head high, put your shoulders back, and you say, I am the head and not the tail. I am an overcomer. I am called. I am chosen. I am redeemed. I am set free. I'm not who I used to be. You've got to speak the blessings of God over your life. Why? Because if you say it enough, you'll start believing it about yourself. And the problem is, some of us, we say we can't, and so what happens is we act as though we're a grasshopper, and so we fight our battles like we're one. We go into the situation thinking we're not going to make it. But you know what the truth was? I looked in Joshua chapter 2, after they've crossed into the promised land. He's gotten them over the Jordan, and the first battle they're going to face is Jericho. So Joshua, he's going to send some spies too. But he learned you don't send 12 because they're going to get it wrong. He sent two. And they met a woman named Rahab who they were going to ask about the situation. And here's what Rahab said in Joshua 2 verse 9. She said, I know. Would you say, I know?
I know.
I know. Now, this is a woman who's a prostitute who doesn't even believe in God. And she says, I know the Lord has given you this land. She knows the truth while the other ones didn't even believe it. I know that he's given you this land, she told them. We're all what? We're afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror. In other words, what Rahab is saying, I believe something about you that you don't even believe about yourself. She's saying, you've got to understand, we're scared of you. Now, let me just tell you why that's important. Did you know that your enemy is scared of you? He's scared of your potential. He's scared of your future because he knows that if you ever saw yourself as God sees you, you'd be unstoppable. You've got to stand up and stand firm and say, no matter what, I'm going to overcome it. Here's number one, stay focused on the promise. Number two, stand firm on the promise. But number three, step forward into the promise. Someone say step forward. You got to step forward into the promise. See, after Caleb stands up and he declares the truth over facts, the 10 spies start trying to get all the people, like I told you, against them. In fact, they even wanted to get rid of Moses and his helper Aaron and find a new leader to take them back into bondage in Egypt. They're scared. They don't know what to do. They're in this wilderness and they say, we're going to die in this wilderness, and if we fight, our kids will be taken away. But Joshua stands up, and here's what he says in Numbers 14, verse 7. He says, or they said to all the people of Israel, the land we traveled through and explored is what? It's a wonderful land. It's a promised land flowing with milk and honey and grapes and pomegranates and figs. It's got promises, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Shalom. It's promises that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He sees it. He says, it's a wonderful land. And if the Lord is pleased with us, he will what? He will bring us safely into that land and give it to us. It is a rich land flowing with milk and honey. Here's what he says. Do not rebel against the Lord, and don't be afraid of the people of the land. They're only, watch this, helpless prey. The 10 spies said that we're like grasshoppers. Joshua said, no, they're the grasshoppers. We've got an enemy that's a grasshopper because we have a God who's a giant. No matter what happens, I'm going to trust God because he's going to take care of it. Joshua says, I'm going to step forward into my promise. And he keeps going. He says, they have no protection, but the Lord is with us. How many know God is with you? He's with you. He's going to take care of you no matter what happens. So don't be afraid of them. They didn't listen. The promised land is right there. Millions of people waiting to get into their promised land. Joshua and Caleb are saying, we can do it. But they won't listen. In fact, they turned away from God. Here's what God said to them. Now tell them this, as surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very things I heard you say. Watch this. You will all drop dead in this wilderness because you complained against me. Every one of you who is 20 years old or older and was included in the registration will die. You will not enter and occupy the land I swore to give you. The only exceptions will be Caleb, son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, son of Nun. I want you to understand something. God said, yeah. You don't want to enter your promised land? Fine, I won't let you. You think your kids will be carried off? Fine, I am going to carry your kids off. I'm going to carry them into the promised land. In other words, there's a generation that died off that day. They died off spiritually. They lived for 40 years wandering in the wilderness, but they died spiritually that day. And they never got to see the promise. But their kids got to see it. And I want to look in this room today and say there's two generations in this room. It may not be an age thing, but it's a mindset thing. There's a generation that says, I won't accept the promises of God, but I'm just going to trust that it's going to be okay. But then there's a generation that says, I'm going to believe what God said is true. I'm going to stand firm when it doesn't seem possible. I'm going to believe that He's going to take care of it. I'm going to trust in God no matter what I face. Cancer, you will bow. Divorce, you will bow. Addiction, you will bow. Because God has given me a promise and I'm going to stand on it. So what kind of generation are you going to be? But I also want to say something to the younger generation, literally. Hear me, young generation. The cutoff is 41, since I'm 40. I'm joking. But let me tell you, generation. The sins of your fathers and mothers don't have to pass to you. You don't have to be a person of addiction. You don't have to be a person of divorce. Just because it happened to your parents doesn't mean it has to happen to you. You stand up. You stand firm. You believe in the promise of God and you watch Him move. Just because your kid, your parents struggled doesn't mean you have to. Because God has given you a purpose and a hope. You believe it and you receive it. How many understand this message? Hold your hands good and high. I want you to understand there's promises for you today. You define what the promise is because God spoke it to you. For some of you, He said you've been called. And you're going to do great things. You maybe haven't been experiencing it, but it's not dead yet. The promise isn't dead yet. For some of you, your kids were raised in church and they've turned from God, but God said, I'm going to restore them back to me. You keep believing that promise. It isn't over yet. For some of you, you're separated right now and you thought that marriage was going to last forever. Don't you give up because God's given you a promise. The question is, are you going to walk into the promised land? You know what I want to say to you? Let's go. Let's go. Who's with me? Anybody want to receive their promised land today? Anybody want to see God move like you know He can today? Let's stand, if you would, right here where we're at. I believe God wants to do something. I believe He wants to move in your life today. Maybe you're here and you've never given your life to God. You've realized that, yeah, there's promises, but honestly, they're not for you because you've not given your life to Him yet. But you want to. There were four earlier today who gave their life to Him. Is there anyone else here today that you'd raise your hand and say, hey, I do need to make it right with God. I want to raise my hand, and I see your hand. You want to become a part of God's family. Anybody else? Anybody else? That's one hand. Anyone else? Two hands. Anybody else? Amen. Two hands. Hallelujah. Can we just thank God for two people saved today? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For those of you with hands raised, in fact, let's just everyone do this. Say, God, forgive me of my sins. Make me a new creation. Help me to walk in your promises. Help me to live in truth. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said that prayer, you're just as much a Christian as anyone else in this room. And I want to speak to everybody. Those of you in this room today that you feel like a dream has been broken. A calling's been shattered. A relationship hasn't been restored. You feel like God has abandoned you, that those promises haven't happened, but yet you want to make a stand. I think one of the greatest things we could do is do a physical act of stepping forward to say, God, I'm trusting in your promises. So we're going to have some worship here. I'm going to invite you all to come. Those who want to walk in your promise, go ahead and come to the front. And we're going to have altar workers here if you want to pray with somebody or maybe you want to get by yourself. But if you would just take that step to say, hey, I'm believing the promises of God, would you just come on down and let's have a time of worship together. Go ahead. Someone break the ice. There you go. And let's just get into this atmosphere of trusting that the promises of God are going to be for you. We're going to sing this song, and as we sing it, I want you to speak it over your family, to speak it over your life, to speak it over your kids right now. So let's sing this song together.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant.
God's giving you some promises.
I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean.
Maybe you take a step forward and say, God, I'm trusting your promises.
I need you now to do the same thing for me. For me, for me. Oh, God, my God, I need you. Oh, God, my God, I need you now.
Come on, cry out to God.
How I need you now.
He hears you. He wants to answer you.
Oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
God's been so faithful. Maybe you haven't seen it, but he's been there.
I'm calling on the God of Mary.
He wants to give you your promised land
today. Whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh, God, my God, I need you. Oh, God, my God, I need you now.
God, we need you.
How I need you now. Oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
Right now in the spiritual, there's some dreams that are being restored. There's somebody who maybe you had a calling and you just push it to the side, but that dream, that passion is coming back right now. That promise that God said you will be in ministry is being restored. There's some marriages that look like they were broken and shattered, but they're being restored right now. There's kids who have been abandoned by their parents, but they're feeling the hope and love from God right now. There's someone who's been in addiction, but they're being set free right now. There's someone who feels like they have no worth, but God brought me here to tell you, you have worth. You've been appointed. You've been chosen. There's someone here right now that you have no idea where your next meal is going to come from, but God's going to provide for you. It doesn't matter who you are. He's given you promises and hope and blessings. Just raise your hands right now as we sing this part, and let's sing it out to God.
You heard your children then. You hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then. God move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You are a healer then. You are. Oh God, my God, I need you now. Oh, rock, oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Oh, God, my God, I need you. Oh, God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. And oh, rock, oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. And oh, how he loves us all. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us all. He loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. And he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us.
Thank you for watching with us. We hope you heard from God today. Remember, scan the QR code so that we can give you your free gift. And don't forget to text 411 to stay up to date on all that's happening at Lifesprings Church.